Yeah,
Hello
perfect.
everyone, do you see my screen?
Yes.
Okay, so great. Thank you everybody for joining our webinar today. Summer is ending, so what we start, the webinar season starts. So today is September 1st, so I have one of my very good partners today to cover, you know, a very interesting topic, because obviously last year, you know, each Amazon seller, whoever was starting on Amazon, they had a huge growth. But of course, you know, all good things come to an end. So right now, a lot of sellers are like in equilibrium, you know, they're plateauing. And the one thing that you need to do in order to scale and make more money is to skyrocket as well, or at least to expand further so you can make more money. So this is why we have the webinar today with Adam Knoza, CEO of Adam Schwartz from Knoza. They're an age full stack agency with the software backing this up. We have Omar, who is an expert in listing and translation optimization for Europe, because, you know, you cannot live without translations. You look dumb, so you don't want that. And we have Daniel Caneja from SellerX. They're one of the major FBA acquirers. So if you guys are sick of running your brand and you want to get a bag of money, you know, they can do that for you. And of course, you can reinvest that in another, like a brand, or you can just go in the beach behind me and you can just kick back for, let's, 3 months until Q4 is over and you can start again from January. So it's your choice. And of course, I'm always introducing myself as the last to speak, because we cover taxes. And you guys, I'm sure you don't want to talk about that, but guess what? You have no choice, because tax authorities don't care if you care or not. I mean, you need to be VAT compliant. So there is, I mean, you have no option. So the discussion today would be to give you tips about how to start, you know, in accelerating and increasing your sales after COVID. So here's the agenda. First, it would go Adam. He'll talk about the strategy, tactics, and what software they're using to help their clients to increase their sales again and start growing. Then, of course, you know, we'll have Omar. Omar is a translation expert with over 10 years experience with helping Amazon sellers. They don't use AI translations because, you know, he'll explain in more details, but, you know, Europe is a very specific, there is 26, 27, if you still count the UK countries. So you cannot avoid that. Then, of course, like I said, Daniel, you know, if you've spent several years, you know, growing your brand and you're at a certain level, you know, you can sell, you can exit your brand and do whatever you want with the money, and they'll take good care of the brands because it's how they make money. You know, they don't just spend money buying brands. They grow them, optimize them, etc. And of course, it is the last speaker always. I'll tell you about how to expand in Europe from the VAT compliance perspective, because that's important. And at the end, we have a Q&A section. So if you have any questions, feel free to write them in the Q&A section or in the chat. If you have to leave to go to the beach or do whatever, I mean, don't worry. You can still type your questions and we'll answer them, and you can watch the recording later. So thank you for joining. And I guess we can start. Adam, it's you, buddy. Go ahead.
All right. Good morning.
Morning.
All right. I am going to screen share right now real quick. And basically, I wanted to just talk about and walk through kind of how our agency, I hope we can see my screen, how our agency thinks about strategy, tactics, and obviously software. I don't want to specifically, don't want it to feel like an advertisement, so I want to talk about how we do it, what we do. From the strategy perspective, when we're thinking of an account, we want to go, what are we going to do to that account? How can we change their business? And I took two very different kind of markets that I thought would be a good example. You know, one was the hair tie, hair coil market. And what I think a lot of sellers under invest time in is just manual research, looking at the top players in the space, looking at how competitive it is. So I took hair ties, sometimes they call them hair coils, and understanding the market. You know, this is a market with fewer keywords. After we did a bunch of research, you know, I always recommend people use Celix, Helium 10, you know, Jungle Scout, the standard software to learn the type of traffic going to certain keywords. and in a certain market. You can obviously look up any competitor ASIN on a tool like Helium 10. And I want to understand how many different keywords are generating a ton of traffic to some of the bigger players like Kitsch in this market or Invisibobble. And so understanding that, after doing that kind of research on using those software tools that are easily accessible, and after manually looking through these listings, you quickly start learning there is a huge amount of traffic to few keywords, hair ties, hair coils. And so knowing that, what would I do if I owned a hair tie business? I want fewer parent listings with more variation options, and not too many. You can obviously start hurting your conversion rate if you had 50 styles, but I picked Invisibobble as an example of, they have two sizes and then obviously different colors. If they had made each one of these a separate listing, they'd be spreading out their ad dollars they're spending, and they'd have significantly less reviews in what's a highly competitive market, right? 28,000 reviews, 16,000 reviews. And as I look at some of the top players, you could clearly see significant review counts, all of which are really highly rated. So if I'm a smaller hair tie company, how do I want to compete here? I want, you know, the strategy side, I'm going to go, I want to invest more dollars in fewer places. I want fewer listings to worry about. So from a strategy perspective, you know, I want to diagnose what's the market look like and how could I ever compete with a market like this? I want to go, you know what, I don't have to be the cheapest option. Obviously, there's a range in prices here. And frankly, I think there's opportunity for more expensive players to rank well here, solely because you don't have to be the cheapest to win on Amazon. Frankly, a lot of the time we see the winners aren't the cheapest. They're the person who is making Amazon the most money. How do you make Amazon the most money? Being fulfilled by Amazon, having a high conversion rate, and having a lot of sales volume and upsells. So again, using Invisibobble just as the example, they're smart. They have a 3-pack, but realistically, they probably want to sell the most of the 8-pack and probably do. Again, the reason being, they want to make Amazon the most money possible. How do you do that? Getting the average order value as high as possible. Just as a very different market, you know, a market our team spent some time in was at-home curriculums. Clearly 2020 was a huge market for that. We were worried the market would fall off a cliff in 2021. Frankly, it hasn't. But if you think about how and start doing some manual research, looking at how people search on Amazon when it comes to curriculums, if you made all of those variations and had 6th grade, 7th grade, 8th grade, 9th grade, 10th grade, all as variations, clearly the customer who searched for the 6th grade curriculum isn't the same customer who's searching for the 10th grade math curriculum. So those would be silly to make variations. Obviously, this is an example of just someone who's heavily advertising here. But this is an example of where our team, after doing research, would go, let's go really wide and narrow. You know, let's go with more listings, less variations, knowing I want my content, when someone searches 6th grade math workbook or math curriculum, to be extremely specific to that category. Rather than if I'm doing hair ties, I could care less about making sure my content is really specific to pretzel brown hair ties. So I thought these were two very different contrasting markets. People are searching very specific topics when it comes to at-home curriculum, what the course is, what the grade is. If there's a, you know, one of the companies we work with in this space, if there's a heavily religious background or not, when it comes to certain topics in curriculum as well. So very different, you know, come up with what the strategy is. Then I'd move to the tactic side. How am I going to get there? And using, going back to just this Invisibobble listing, we don't manage them. I just thought it was a good example of one of the market leaders in this space, building a double variation, and the tactics being understanding how to use Variation Wizard, building them properly, and doing a lot of research to understand what variations did my competitors use and who's doing it the smartest, because every variation or many variations behave differently. Sometimes the content changes when you switch between variations. Sometimes it doesn't. Sometimes the thumbnails switch, or I guess the thumbnails always switch, but the title changes in some variations, sometimes it doesn't. So those are just kind of examples of, and when it comes to tactics, building out the advertising strategy as well, knowing there's few keywords to target here, I would build a sponsored product campaign, manual keyword exact, and want to pump my dollars right into hair ties and hair coils as exact keywords, versus if I'm doing this type of ad strategy, what's the tactic we're going to implement? We're probably going to have 50 or 100 or 150 ad campaigns, 5 or 10 focused on every single, you know, sixth grade math curriculum, very finite specific campaigns for every single ASIN, rather than lumping them all together and just making an automatic campaign. You can make that for discovery in categories like this, but we would definitely, as an agency, recommend building specific, you know, focused, potentially using a phrase campaign, sixth grade math blank, right? Because it could be workbook, it could be curriculum, as just an example, and making very focused fifth grade, each one being in a separate campaign. So you also have the luxury of pumping or focusing your dollars on top of search in a category like this, right? You have high reviews, people are going to do research. So in a category like this, you may also do well with product pages as a placement to spend more money on it. And just go after going through those two, the other piece I wanted to talk about was leveraging software. Amazon's become too competitive to not use software, whether you're using public tools, Helium 10, Celix, Jungle Scout, any of those. And also making sure you're using a revenue recovery tool is what we call it. Revenue reimbursement is also another term for it. You know, Refund Sniper, Refund Manager, Get IDA are all tools that do it. We've built our own, frankly. This is our internal tool. This is one of my brands. I don't mind showing the data. But just as an example, understanding how you're getting refunds. People say to me all the time, and I hear brands say it, I already do that myself. Don't worry about it. I don't care how big you are. I've probably seen maybe two accounts with 8 or 9 figures that were properly doing all revenue recovery themselves. At the very least, I always tell people, pick one of the companies out there. We sell one, but I also just tell people, pick one of them as an umbrella backup to your accounts. I always think alerts, you know what's going on your listing. Amazon breaks listings all day, every day. And this is an example. Again, we built this tool for ourselves, but there's a bunch that are out there that you could pay $20 a month for. Know what's going wrong with your listings at any given time. You know, Amazon will change the title on your product. Sometimes it's on purpose. Sometimes it's malicious from a competitor. Sometimes your team's changing it. Sometimes Amazon's algorithm's changing it. You should know what's going on your listings all the time. You know, here's an example of Amazon breaking storefront. We need to go back and fix it. I like to point out reviews as a big piece that everyone should have software supporting as well. Terms of service compliant reviews. This is our internal version, but if you actually went, this is a different brand I own, so I don't mind sharing data, and I figured I'd use a Dundee Award. If you go to in your orders and click on an order, any order that's been delivered 5 to 30 days, you can always request a review. I can click yes. Our software figures out the ideal day to request reviews and then actually sends the requests on that day to get the highest likelihood of a conversion rate. But it's a manual process, but there's several tools out there to request reviews automatically. One other new feature that I think a lot of people aren't utilizing today, we just built our software tool for it, and I know there are a couple out there, is if you go into brands and then customer reviews, you can actually narrow down to 1 to 3 star reviews, and you can leverage right here messaging customers because there's two options. One's offer a refund. The other one's basically ask them why they wrote a one-star review. You know, are they happy? Are they unhappy? Clearly, they're unhappy. The goal of this is to engage the customer. If they went, hey, my product arrived broken. Hey, I thought it was this or that. Potentially, you can communicate with the clients to get a one-star review converted to a five-star review. Obviously, that's going to heavily help your review rate if you can get one-star reviews to five-star reviews. Again, something that we've automated now, but even if you're left doing it manually, it's worth doing. You know, getting a one-star review to a five-star review is the equivalent of, you know, four or five five-star reviews. So whether you have to offer a refund, whether you just have to engage the customer and understand their issues, that's valuable. And one other place I wanted to show people real quick, I'm sure I'm almost out of time, but if you go to brands and then customer engagement, this account doesn't have access to it, but go look in your account. This is an amazing tool when you have access to it to cross promote new products that you're selling to existing customers. Amazon wants to be a marketing channel for you. And so this is a place brands and then customer engagement that larger brands are getting access to it first, and they're slowly giving access to smaller brands. And if you get access to it, test it. You'll be able to promote some of your newer products that don't have a lot of reviews to all of the customers who have bought your other products. And it's going to generate a lot of awareness and a quick influx of sales. So I always just want to point out some new things when I'm speaking. This is one newer feature that I'm seeing on larger accounts. Leverage it. It's going to make you a lot of money. Like all Amazon tools, it's going to be great until it gets oversaturated. So right now, when you get access to it, it won't be. Use it. I've spoken for a while. Obviously, I think I'm ready to pass the baton and answer any questions later for everyone.
Thanks, Adam. You know, it's always good to have insights from somebody who knows what to do, and they do it for a living. No, he's not just talking. You know, this is what these guys do. And of course, no, this is like the management part, because any of you, you might start by yourself, but usually when you try to expand, it's good to use an agency, because these guys are doing that day to day. They help other clients. They see all the challenges and they find solutions. And like Adam, our next speaker, Omar, they do that, and they have been doing that for 10 years. And they cover a very important and specific part when expand in Europe. And I know that because I used to be an e-commerce seller as well. And we've done a lot of horrible translations with agencies and other people looking funny, looking ridiculous. So you don't want to make the same mistake. So this is now why what Omar does, and he'll explain in detail what they do, okay, how they do it, etc. So come on, Omar, it's you now.
Okay, perfect. I'm trying to keep it short. I mean, it's already hard that I needed to cut this all down a little bit, so I will be jumping in directly. Let me share my screen. Here we go. Where is it? Let's go straight here. Okay, just hold on. Where do we have you? Here. Okay, because I need to trim this down, I wrote it actually down so I can be focused and not talk too much about, as if I'm talking for 1 hour. So everyone gets some value out of this. So yeah, obviously we're talking about tips to combat the post-COVID plateauing on Amazon 2021. My name is Omar Angri. I'm the CEO of Margin Business. And yeah, we'll be talking about the importance of localization and optimization on Amazon Europe. Country-specific micro-optimization technique is what we call it. And it's all about localization within the European market, which is super important. We can begin already with the storefront, with the A-plus content, photos. You see it as you pay rent in a physical shop. When you go into a shop, for example, it's dusty everywhere, or you just from outside. Would you like to buy? No, me, I don't like to buy. So I would move on and go to the next shop and see something which is nice, you know? So you need to see the optimization of your listing as an investment. What I've seen 10 years ago, it was okay. There was no problem. You just could, just put your listing on there and you could sell even more and sell even a lot more, you know? But now maybe your sales you know, are only 25% of what you really can do. So if you do the investment, you can really make a lot more, a lot money more. I mean, we are here, everyone is here for the money. We don't do this for fun, you know? So obviously because we like it, and the Amazon sellers, they like as well what they do, but they as well, they're in for the money. So the maximum we need to get out of it, of our investment, is obviously the ROI. We need to have the return of investment. So very important, invest in your listing. Listing optimization, localization, translation, photos, A+ content. Everything what comes into the listing, we need to take care of. So one of the reasons I mentioned this as well is now the Amazon aggregators, like we have Seller X. The thing is, they are coming in very, very big steps. What's going to happen with most of the sellers, they're going to get under the steps. Either they get bought from them, or they're going to get kicked out the game after a few years. The ones which don't want to invest. There is a lot of foreign sellers which haven't invested yet. Their listing look crazy horrible, but they still make money. But this will change because Amazon aggregators are coming in. They're going to invest. They're going to help the companies. They're going to use their resources in order to hire the best they can, or even partner with the one with the best they can. And they will just flood the market like that. So if people don't go now for it, I would say it's too late, or there will be never a real growth curve of what we really want. So what can happen? Yes, now we go to translation. Sorry about the the all aggregator thing and everything. Let's keep it very simple. What are the bad things that can happen? So there is an example of Rapseed was translated into rape for a Swedish listing. When Sweden opened up, they use Google Translator. And obviously, like they always say, yeah, I don't need no translation agency, which is Amazon specialized. I just put them on like this, and this is what happens. So customers don't trust any sellers which are doing this. I mean, in Europe, most of the times it's like this. Germans, very skeptical of nature. You cannot force a German to buy. You have to take his hand. You have to walk him through to the product, present him the product. And if he like it, he will buy one, he buy two, he buy three, and he even bring other customers. But if you force the person, then it won't happen. So the listing needs to be really adapted to the country. That's why we are doing the Amazon country-specific optimization for the customer, which includes the photos, which includes the text, the localized text, the German text for a German customer. Why can't you just hire a translator from Fiverr or Upwork? Yes, you can do that. That's not a problem. Do you have a SOP? Do you have anything in place where you can train the translator? Because if you just let them translate, you have a very good translation, which makes sense to translate, but there's no marketing inside. There is no Amazon experience inside. There is so many facts. So now you have seven of these. So do you want to deal with seven European languages, hiring them, training them, let them optimization tools? We all know Helium 10 is not the easiest. You need a few weeks to adapt with it. You know, this is everything. I mean, no problem. Everyone can do that, you know, but for me still, I know that business owners have something else to do with their time. So they have to, obviously hire somebody for that. And the best is an agency, as we all are agencies and all have our specialties. Everyone should hire an agency to do this work in order to get free and make obviously more money. So you need also to look at the localization experience in this. So you, like I said, you can have a translator, but he needs to know how to talk to a customer. He needs to understand the culture. Buy now won't work. In other cultures is normal. Like in the States, it's normal. You can say buy now. People would even say, oh, okay, buy now and the quote on top of it. Good. But in Germany, it won't work. Not yet. Okay. So yeah, and on top of all that, you know, I have been working with Japanese translators. And when I look at Japanese, I'm like, okay, now I know that it's kind of Japanese, but you know, who's gonna know what they've wrote, you know? So I have to have a translator and a proofreader. because the translator can make mistakes as well, and the proofreader will go over it and will confirm that it's good. So this is another problem when you really don't, when even my capacities are going away and I cannot check the languages anymore. Obviously, I'm not good in all languages, but proofreading is done by all native speakers as well. So what do we have here? Just a second. To wrap this up, why native speakers again? The person should be able to find keywords which non-native machines don't find. So we have a lot of foreign sellers which come at space one in the US, in Germany, in France. They use keywords they find when they first analyze the other listings. And obviously they're gonna rank space one. Why? If you look at the keywords in their title, they make absolutely no sense sometimes. I mean, they're inversed. The words are not really the product what they want. So we have something really messy there. So this is where we come in. We go, actually, we search for the a little bit lower keywords, which makes sense for the population, build them in, and voila, they can find their products with their own words and don't even see the other foreign listings, which didn't make any effort to rank on the European marketplaces. You win customer trust. Culturally, when customers know you speak their language, you win their trust. In any language is like that. Me, I'm not a native English speaker. If I try to sell something in the United States, then it can be hard for me, you know. So this is what we as well working on the localization in the specific countries for the specific listings as well. As well, the negative reviews. Every country has different points how they look at the reviews. For Italy, it might be, I don't know, I throw something in the room, they are very, they're looking, they like people, they like clean people, they like, I mean, everyone likes clean people, but I mean, like, they like getting dressed very nicely. It's a very specific etiquette, how they have their listings, how they presenting the brands, for example. On the other side, let's say the Americans, when they advertise, it's very, very strong. It's like a giant is walking. I like it as well, you know, but it's everyone has different approach. So when you read the reviews, you can pull out of the reviews of the customer what they like, what they dislike, and build it into your listing for the specific countries. And after a while, you will see you need to have all of these differences need to be seen within the countries. So this is as well how you can work on it through the negative reviews. That's what I mean as well through different countries. So you have every A+ content, which has to be unique. Obviously you don't have to do it, but if it makes sense, like when there's the cultural aspect is really too, when there's too many different things, then you just change the pictures, change the text. Have a look at the competitors as well and make sure they're local sellers. Like I already said, when we have foreign sellers, they tempt to put on the pictures, they copy others and they might copy as well the other foreign sellers. So we have a turnaround, which they don't go really in the cultural aspects. So again, check the reviews, use the reviews to your advantage. I know I don't have a lot of time. That's why I'm trying to never have a set it and forget it strategy. This is the one thing, what I'm always saying, because most of people, what they do, they say, I do it right now. So it's already hard for them to do the whole listing, you know, because they cannot do it on themselves and they get upset because they have to pay. But this mentality is completely wrong. We're here in it for the money. So invest money in order to receive money. So it's not only one time that you do the listing, that you do your photos, that you do everything. It's all the time. I mean, you don't have to do every time, every month a photo shoot, for sure not. But you have to check that everything is well optimized, that you target the correct PPC keywords, that you target the correct competitors, that you really have everything in hand and you know what's going on with your product and what's going on with the competitors and what's going on in general with the market. If not, your initial investment will be lost. Yes, one more two more things. Your product listing should be different from one country to another. I already mentioned this. Sorry, there is this annoying thing here, which I need to move. I know everything what I said right now implicates a lot of work, a lot of organization, and obviously a lot of investment. But like I said, you need to invest in order to make profit. It's a never-ending game. It's every business is like that. E-commerce is not different. It was different. Maybe we could make money with doing not so much. But now, really, we have not only money, we have as well put ourselves really 100% into it. This is not a game. We are really in e-commerce. Amazon is a giant right now, and we go into another dimension at the moment. So I give a quick example of what I'm talking about, why it's so important. For example, I don't know, I'm very into sports, so I'm having a lot of protein here and there. So Optimum Nutrition is a very big brand. Mostly, if you do some sports, some kind of sports, you know them. They have a very appealing photos. They have this the first photo. I didn't have put the other photos on. I think I can tell you from what I'm will tell you now. You will see the photos yourself in your visual mind. There is chocolate. It's splashing. There is a very nice trained people on the pictures who are actually training. Everything looks really chocolatey. So this thing, there is real chocolate inside. Okay. So when you look at the text, it's still not 100%, but it's okay. It's okay, but they still can add another 30-40% on their winnings. So they make already $300,000 within 1 month in the German market. Okay. So it's pretty okay, but they can do more. So they still haven't optimized 100% and they still didn't localize the listing 100%, but their A+ content and their pictures are amazing. Now we go to Pro GNC, nutrition, which looks for me like medical supply. And they don't put an effort in photos here. Obviously, I put the photos, type of photos in, they are just not good enough. So here we have the text is completely Google translated in German as well. And they don't rank for anything. And they give away everything to our nutrition for free, for free. So they make like 30 sales per month and they're so big. So if this is my example, what I want to say, it don't matter if you're a small brand or if you're a big brand. If you don't put money into your listing, it will not work for you. Okay. The conclusion here, as for the real world, your storefront listing is important. The visual perception, all customers are looking at your brand. So you need to be 100% presentable. Native speakers, they need to have Amazon and marketing experience. And because the profiles of these type of people, what you need for this type of job are very rare. So they need training. We offer already all the packages, so we have it. So the only thing what sellers need to do is to come to us to tell us, listen, we need this, and we can deliver. One special bonus. There has been a change in the Amazon Europe market, the European marketplace. This is really good for American sellers now, and as well for anyone who sells in the European Union who don't know yet. Normally you have the pan-European, you have the photos, which are for each country are the same, because when you upload, they go all for all countries are the same. Now, right now you can upload country by country your photos, which is amazing because you can actually write the text in each and every language and each and in every country. And if you wish, you can even change the pictures according to the localization and to the country as well. So this is really a breakthrough. It's super amazing. And I'm really excited that this offer has now been offered by Amazon. Although it's a bit hard to access it. And it really depends. It's not just like there. You need really, it's hard to access and you need to apply. But if anyone is interested in that, just send me an email. I will get back to you with the direct instructions how to do that. Okay. Thank you very much. I think I'm a bit over the time, but I tried really to speak fast and make it very clear.
You did fast and we understood what you were talking about. So the conclusion is the following. Average doesn't work out anymore. You cannot be average. You need to be either A plus, big or small, it doesn't matter. You know, you need to either change or you go under. Okay, so if you listen to advices of Omar and other companies, and if you make sure that you're on top of your game, and if you're on top of your sales, then I mean, this is where, you know, SalesX, you know, they can help you out, because they're the companies who buy successful brands, and of course they turn them into even bigger brands. So thank you, Daniel, for joining today. Tell us what you guys do with all these millions that you have in your pockets. What do you do?
Pleasure. No, it's great to be here. And yes, exactly. That's what we do. We look for brands that are doing well on Amazon, and what we try to take them to a next level. So if you want, I'll also share some slides that we've prepared. I guess you guys can see my screen, right?
Yes, we can.
Perfect. So, I mean, for those of you who don't know what an aggregator is, and I know Omar briefly touched on it, basically we're new kind of players that have arrived to Amazon in particular. And what we do is we look for brands that are doing really well on Amazon. And what we try is we invest a lot of money and resources to take them to the next level and grow them around the world. So effectively, I mean, to tell you a little bit more about who we are at SellerX and what we do, we are the largest Amazon FBA aggregator, and we've got presence in four countries already. I mean, I sit in London, but our headquarters is in Berlin. We've got people in Miami, people in Shenzhen. As you were mentioning, I mean, we've raised $250 million so far, which is an awful lot of money. But the point is, the business model works really well in the sense that we look for entrepreneurs that are doing something and that's working, that they've demonstrated that the product is someone that's working really well. And in Amazon, which, as you know, Amazon is probably one of the most competitive marketplaces. And what we like to do is we take that product and we help them grow everywhere. So how do we do this? I'll skip this slide. But there's a lot of ways that we help it grow. So number one is, well, there's a lot of ways we can improve the efficiency. And a few of these things are similar to what Omar was mentioning. We also have like a dedicated team to go through all the listings, improve the content, and make sure that it's translated into every language perfectly. There's A-plus content, all the branding is perfect. We also look at advertising. We look at, make sure we're ranking for the best keywords. We've got a specialized team there. Same with logistics. I mean, I think our logistic team now is like 50 people. And what we try is to see what we can do in order to improve the way we send things to Europe and to the US. And similarly, I mean, that's just on Amazon in terms of what we can do to improve the listings itself. The second growth lever that we have is scaling. And here we have things like Amazon Pan-EU program, but also taking it to all the different Amazon marketplaces, because some of them are easy to access and some might take a bit more time, but the fact that we have a very large team helps us take it to all the markets quickly. And then the last thing, which is a little bit more, a bit of a long-term ambition and something that obviously takes much longer, is to expand channels. And this is where Shopify becomes interesting, other marketplaces like eBay, Walmart, and also move brands online to different offline channels. So basically what we've done so far, I mean, I like this slide because we've only been operating for 1 year, but we've already bought 30 brands. We've got 250 employees, 250 million of funding. So almost 1 million per employee and four locations worldwide. And that's what we want, right? We want to find some of the best entrepreneurs because I mean, for context, I used to be an Amazon FBA seller. I sold my business to a private investor. And I noticed that like starting a business and growing it is difficult, but taking it to a next level, it becomes really, really difficult because you need a lot of capital invested. You need to invest in resources and people etc. And a lot of people are not prepared to do that and don't want to do that. They prefer to be product innovators or product launchers, and they don't want to spend the time in and effort into building a huge company. So that's where we come in, and we become very, very useful for these sellers. Maybe just quickly as well on our team. I mean, this is our leadership team. We've got Malte, who's both of our founders met at Harvard doing the MBA. Malte has 10 years of experience in e-commerce. He founded Dafiti, which for the ones that don't know, it's one of the largest South American fashion company. Philip comes with more from like an M&A background, being former Goldman Sachs and private equity investor. And I think what's a little bit special about us is we try to have a lot of Amazon expertise. So our chief marketing officer used to be the head of Amazon FBA Europe. Then we've got Simon, who's our head of growth, who used to be the head of Amazon 360 program in Europe. And so on. I mean, we try to really leverage the Amazon expertise in order to better grow the brands that we acquire. Then, I mean, I think that's almost last. The only thing I wanted to touch on, because we get this question all the time, is sort of how the process works. And the good thing here is, because we're talking about Amazon FBA businesses, all the data is already available and all very easy to do. So the way it works is, since our first conversation all the way to closing the deal, we can do this in 30 to 35 days, and which is very, very quick when you compare it to a traditional M&A process that normally takes 3 to 4 months. So the thing is, I mean, as you were saying at the beginning, if for people that are tired of Amazon and tired of the complexities that come and the rules that change, in a way you can make them millionaires very, very quickly. Within a month, they can have the money. And after that, we just need them for 12 more weeks on a part-time basis, helping us to transition and run the brand. So maybe also conscious of time and to finish it off, I mean, I'll just share my contact details. I mean, if anyone's interested in selling their business as the next step, by all means, drop me a line. We have this thing where we offer a free valuation to everyone that messages us. So whether you're interested in selling or just want to know how much your business is worth, send me an email and we can have a chat.
Okay, thank you, Daniel. So like Daniel said, you know, after the event, we'll send the recording. You have Omar, Daniel, Adam, and my contacts, and you can ask all your questions. So I'm last, and that's for a reason, because regardless if you know what to do, either you would like to start right now or you would like to sell your brand, you know, you cannot avoid taxes. You know, there is nothing certain in life, but definitely taxes. I'm sure Adam knows that. Benjamin Franklin, who is on the $100 bills, he said that. So it's true right now, and it was true 300 years ago. So this is not what we do in hellotax. Just give me a second to share my screen and to show you what we do besides all these great partners today. So, and I'll be quick as a tax, as an accountant checking your books today. So here is what we do. So hellotax, what we do. I mean, the short story is the following. You know, the co-founders, they used to be Amazon sellers. They met online in a Facebook group chatting about how to solve their VAT compliance issue. So what they do, what they decided to do, they set up a VAT solution as a SaaS service to help e-commerce sellers to expand across Europe and still being VAT compliant. So, and why Europe? I mean, for those of you who don't know, I mean, the States is the biggest market, and after it now goes Germany. And besides Germany, in Europe, we have 400 plus million potential clients. So after the USA, Europe is the next place where you should go. But of course, you transform your brand from a local to global one. And of course, and the other thing is, now your competitors are either looking into that, some of them are reluctant, so you should be proactive. You should do that and grow to Europe. And of course, to do that, you know, it's really hard, like Omar said, because Europe, you know, there is multiple markets, multiple translations, and on the tax side, I mean, there is a few things that you need to know, and tax authorities would require to that regardless of if you're aware or not. So you need to know what's your VAT liability from the past and present, how much you own and how much you need to pay. you need to register for VAT on in one or more countries. This is the regular process. You need to have a view of the movement of goods import, exports, transfers between countries. And of course, we need to have the complete visibility of the sales across all your channels, Amazon, Shopify, B2B, whatever, everything. So you need to be aware of that. So you need to be aware also of the different VAT rates across Europe, which are around 20, but that's not good enough when you file your report and pay your VAT. So it's 23 in Ireland, it's 20 in France, it's 19 in Germany. It's a mess. So, I mean, you need to know that. Complexity of the actual VAT registration. You know, Poland is one of the easiest, and Spain is one of the hardest because of documents required, automation, etc. So it's not the same way you do it in the States. So it's very different. And why you need to register for Europe, in Europe, of course. I mean, there is two reasons. First, the one which was active before July 1st was the distance selling threshold, which is no longer valid after July 1st with the introduction of the one-stop shop. And the second reason for registering for VAT is if you store goods in any of the markets in Europe. If you do that, you need to register. So what are the actual blockers? Omar just explained about the language barrier in translations. And then the next big issue is taxes, the value-added tax and the customs. The value-added tax is equivalent to the sales tax in the States, but the difference is that it's not one country like in the States. There are 26 different countries in the European Union. So what is our solution? Because we're doing that for clients, we do multiple registrations, we cover major markets in Europe. So we've decided to build a package which is called Expansion to You. And the reason for that is really simple, to make expansion simple. Because if you come to us and you would like to register for 10 markets, no, we can do that. But honestly, there is no point of doing that. The first and most important thing to do is to establish yourself in one market. And we're the package which we offer is Germany. Why Germany? It's the biggest market in Europe. They accept documents in English and they're centrally located in Europe. And like I said, they're the second largest market after Amazon. So it's no brainer. The registration takes from 1 month for US sellers to 3 to 4 months for Chinese sellers. And after you do that, we have a customs partner, you know, who helps you to get the so-called IO registration so you can import goods. We get the VAT. And the next thing that you need to do is to set up the so-called one-stop shop. The one-stop shop is the new VAT regime starting from July 1st, which allows you to do one VAT registration in Germany, one-stop registration in Germany, and you can deliver B2C sales to everybody in the European Union, meaning that you have outreach to 400 plus potential customers, and you just need to do one VAT registration and one OSS registration, meaning expansion made easy. And by doing that, you would be able to test and sell your product in all these markets. And if you see that you're selling great in France, perfect. I mean, you can establish a storage there, you can do the VAT registration there, but of course, you don't need to invest in advance in all this bureaucratic stuff, which any business owner hates. So that's the solution. We do the registration for you. We have a customs partner who do the customs and import stuff, and we do the OSS registration. We do the filings for you monthly for the VAT, quarterly for the one-stop shop. So we have a digital software where you just log in, you connect your Amazon channel, or soon we'll have Shopify and all the other major ones. But the idea is to have all the data in one place. We file the reports, and the only thing that you need to do is pay the returns. There is like a free VAT portal, meaning that you can use that even if you're not a client of us, and monitor all your sales. And as simple as that, we're at the end of the event and we're at the Q&A section. So I have 10 plus questions. So let's start, guys. Just give me a sec. Okay, here is the first question. It's from anonymous attendee. There is a tool on Amazon to translate listings automatically. Why this is not enough to use, I guess? Why this is not a good option? That's for Omar.
As already said, all tools, it's similar to Google Translate. They all translate, it's machine translations, which make your customers not confident. So they will not be happy seeing this, and there were, if they see another listing which is 100% has the 100% good translation and it speaks to them, like you know, the listing is like it opened their mouth and it speaks to them, please buy me, you know. And if they can connect to that listing, then everything is good. But you know, if they have no clue and they just do machine translations out of let's say, I don't know, even from Spanish or from any other, it's different. It's a different approach, you know. So I don't say English, because English is very similar. Although the U, there is in German, for example, there is another form which you use for addressing a person, which falls away, unfortunately, right now, which I still use in the listings, just by the way, to keep it more formal. Anyway, this is the reason.
Okay. So as Omar just said, you know, if you're a business owner, if you don't put the effort in creating like proper translation, why should they put the effort to buy your product? They'll go to somebody else. So as simple as that. So here is, you know, a few, there is other questions. This one is from Yoni. That's actually from me. Why do you recommend Germany is the place to start in Europe for VAT, etc.? Okay, I mean, I think I mentioned that, but okay, Yoni, so this is the reason. No, the German Amazon market is the second largest after Amazon US. So that's the first reason. It's a huge market. Second, it's located centrally in Europe, meaning that you can do sales and you can deliver to the rest of Europe from there. Number three, German tax authorities, they accept documents in English when you would like to register, meaning that they make this easy as possible. And that's a very good reasons to know. And they're very quick with some markets. So this is the place to go. So I think we covered that. So let me check what is the next question. Next question is from Pablo Reco Wons. Why bother with pro translations? Can't you just use Google Translate? I think you answered that with your previous question. So let me go ahead with the next one. Next one is from Oleg. The average cost per click for advertising has doubled over the past year. Where do you expect this to go in the future? I think that's for Adam. Adam, that's for you.
What was the first part of it?
The average cost per click for advertising has doubled over the past year. Where do you expect this to go in the future?
Oh, we expect it to get worse. Much worse. So it's we've seen it double, and we've seen our data, you know, across the macro of whatever 200 something accounts that we have access to, and it's only continued to go up. I think there was a 1 month recently we saw a dip, maybe I want to say July, but other than that, it continues just on an upward trend. And we suspect it's going to keep going up. It's going to get more expensive. Amazon's become pay to play. People realize that they have to go buy the spot to even be able to have the potential to compete. So I suspect it's going to keep going up. It's going to get a bigger barrier for entry, you know, and I think people are going to realize that, I hate to say it, time's of the essence when it comes to competing on Amazon, because it will get too expensive to enter competitive categories unless you show up with a ridiculous amount of money.
I see. Okay. Thanks, Adam. There is one question from Emily. I'm not sure who would answer that. I'm not the one, that's for sure. Did any of you try the A-B split testing Amazon offered for main photo? Does it give you good insight? I think it's Omar, Adam, you. Did any of you try the A-B split testing Amazon offered for main photo? Does it give you good insight?
I didn't test it yet.
So we haven't found any of the A-B test tools that are out there or Amazon's ultimately to be that helpful. At the end of the day, we like to test out content, test out strategies, let it run for a couple of weeks, assuming everything else is pretty static, which is really never the case, but you can make some inferences. Review the unit session percentage. We often call that Amazon's conversion rate. Review how it impacts your traffic, your click-through rate when it comes to advertising. I prefer still using the strategy of building out, you know, changing content, let it run for a week or two, depending on how much traffic and sales occur on that listing, and then switching it and comparing the data versus Amazon's A/B testing. It just hasn't been that beneficial to us to date.
Okay, one question.
Actually, now I remember I used it a few days ago and the results came back. It was a very good insight because the photo that I was like very keen for was completely down by the ones who wanted the photo. So the two photos, the ones that I wanted, was out of the game, you know? So, yeah.
Okay, thanks, guys. So another question from Alan, who is actually a comment on, it's something that Adam mentioned earlier. So I heard Adam comment on PPC scary, but does this mean that Amazon aggregators will be successful? They will buy the best brands and have the deepest pocket. So I'm not sure, you know, probably Daniel, you need to relieve these guys that know you guys have a lot of money, that's for certain. This actually is for competitive people, you know, you just need to upscale your brand, I mean, your game. I used to be a business seller 10 years ago. I've done that for 10 years and I quit selling because no, it's very crowded right now. So you need to be perfectionist and obviously, and this is why you need to use other tools because PPC, of course, it's important, but you need to make sure that everything in your game is perfect so you can compete. And at certain level, they can buy your brand. I think that's the solution, I think. The other option is probably if somebody of the other marketplace start catching up with Amazon, so they're not they're not the major market. But I guess now you guys can give your insight as well.
No, exactly. I think it's what everyone's been saying, right, Omar and yourself, that like basically we're raising the bar in terms of competition. So everyone needs to raise their game in terms of improving the listing, improving the PPC, and there's need to be a little bit of an investment from sellers that want to compete, and for the ones that don't, that maybe the best action is to sell.
I see. Okay, we have one question. I think that's for Omar. Can we list in English in Germany? That's from Emily.
The same reason we cannot list in Spanish in the United States. There are English speakers in the European Union, but they're not enough. So we need to keep it for the local speakers.
Okay, and since you're talking again, another question from an anonymous attending. Can you translate keywords?
No, please not. Absolutely not. Okay, you need to do a real research, competitive research, and then the keyword research.
Okay, one question from Andy Tilly. What is better, the regular reporting or the one-stop shop that you just mentioned? So, I mean, the regular reporting requires you to register in multiple markets, meaning more cost and more like bureaucratic issues, or not issues, but no, just it takes more time. The one-stop shop is built for the specific reasons. You select the home country in Europe, you do the VAT, you do the one-stop shop, and you can deliver and sell to the rest of Europe. So easy way to start selling. And after, I mean, it's simple as that's how it works. So it's made for reason to encourage sellers to grow. One question, that this one is from Nish. That's for, I think, how are you different from other acquirers? Why should they sell to you? I guess that's for you, Daniel. How are you guys different? I guess that's the question.
Yeah, it's a great question. I mean, I think what's a little bit different from us is, one, we're the biggest player in Europe, so that helps us when we want to expand into Europe. But also the second thing is we've got presence in other countries. So if you think your brand can be a global brand, we really think we can be one of these aggregators that can take it globally and really expand it. Number two is I think what makes us a little bit different is from our core, we're able to offer the seller whatever they want in terms of deal structure and commitment in the firm. So we've seen a lot of sellers that after they sold their business, they have stayed with us at Seller X and they work in different departments because that's what they want to do, maybe only on product research or maybe on marketing, depending on what they specialize and what they like. And the other thing is other ones, like for example, that just wanted a clean exit, they didn't want an earnout in the payment, etc. We've just done that, paid them whatever they wanted, and now they're off to do new ventures. So in that respect, we tend to be a bit more flexible than a lot of the aggregators out there. and help her adapt to whatever the seller wants.
And I want to chime in for this as well. We've worked with, or you know, have relationships with, I'd say over a dozen of the aggregators that are out there. A bunch of them use our software. We know SellerX well. We manage an account or two with them. One of the things that stands out to me, in the generic sense of all the aggregators, I find some of them just go, I want a market leader. I don't want to do anything to it. And just, I'm going to tread water. And I think we're all seeing that the idea of treading water doesn't work. And when I spoke to Malta, their founder, his big comment was, we can't just tread water. We have to double, triple the brands that we buy. And I also think that helps the founders, because it also gives a founder room to know, A, their brand's being protected, and there are several benefits to that. And B, it's probably going to mean a better exit for the founder, because SellerX is buying it off potential, not buying it off of only what it is today. And I'm not going to throw any names in, but the more research you'll do in the wide scope of the aggregators, the more you'll see there's a lot of people that are buying 10 brands and saying, if one works, wonderful, and kind of using the venture model as an aggregator. And I think that's a very flawed model.
Yeah, exactly. Like in the crypto industry, you know, you buy 100 coins, and with the idea that few of them will make like 100 multiple and you can make money. So that's a good approach from SellerX. No, you guys don't just acquire the brands, but you acquire talents, because obviously since these guys grew their brands, I mean, they know what to do. So that's good. And we have actually a few more questions. That's what happens if you don't your VAT in order or not a VAT? Oh, I mean, you guys don't have an option with the VAT anymore. They will suspend your account. So, I mean, you don't try that. So this for the first question. Is the second one is from the same attendee. Is it mandatory to have VAT number to sell in Germany, even if you do FBM? I'm not sure if you're in the EU or non-EU, you will be required, because for the exact same reason. You know, if you're outside the EU and you decide to fulfill your own orders and deliver to Europe, you will be required to register for the so-called import one-stop shop. And in this case, the Amazon will collect your VAT. So you need to have, you pay VAT. As simple as that. There is no way around that anymore. So here's another question for Daniel. You mentioned looking into expanding the brands you acquire into other marketplaces, or create brands outside of the marketplace, such as Shopify. With a brand that does different type of items, how do you propose to build the brand outside of Amazon? Perhaps review the best-selling items and create a brand out of it. I think, you know, Daniel, you can read the question. It's pretty long.
Yeah, no, thank you. I just read it. I think in short, the answer is we look at it on a case by case basis, in the sense that like we've looked and acquired brands that, as you say, may sell across different product categories, and where it's difficult or the brand message is not that straightforward. So there we go a little bit back to a drawing board and see what brand can we actually build from there. Because, I mean, as everyone knows here, not every brand on Amazon is a brand that you can actually create a household name and grow everywhere. So we look at it on a case-by-case basis. What's a little bit interesting about our way and our channel expansion, what we do is, basically, we go to, once we look to go to other retailers, for example, Walmart, et cetera, the way we sort of approach them is we approach them with our umbrella brands and say, like, look, we have all these brands. We think these ones might be particularly good. And that's sort of what we try to leverage, like not only sell like one thing, but being able to offer these bigger groups or bigger channels a lot of possibilities and a lot of brands that we own.
Okay. Thanks, Daniel. One question that's, I think it's for me. Do I need to have a business registered in each EU country to import product and sell on Amazon? No, you're not required. And this wide expansion to EU package is created by us, because the only thing that you know is we will introduce the custom agents. They'll help import your stuff and you can start selling in Germany and then rest of Europe. So as simple as that. And I think we have one or two more questions and we're done, guys, because we went over the 1 hour. There is one interesting question which was sent to me before the event of one registrant, Timo Bremer, I guess German from the name. that's for Cerex. Do you have an FBA academy where you help brands who are not good fit for acquisition to be groomed and optimized? All right, it's a very interesting question, by the way.
We don't have an academy as such where we help grow brands. What we've done is, especially brands that have engaged us that we see a lot of potential but might be a little bit too small or too early, is we put them in touch with different people. So we've had cases where somebody that just didn't get out to a threshold in terms of sales, but we looked at the business and they were doing terrible marketing. So we put them in touch with our marketing team and we've helped them with their marketing campaign. But yeah, as to answer the question, we don't really have like an accelerator program as such.
Okay. That's good, because I've discussed that with some other partners in the industry. And this is probably what could happen. You know, you don't turn them down. I mean, you simply help them to grow, because eventually, you know, once they grow, they will be a good fit for that. So one question from Alan Daniels, comment about bundling brands. So many brands seems absolutely correct. Just like Procter & Gamble and all the traditional old-fashioned collection of brands in the US and Europe. I guess that's a comment. Of course, I mean, consolidation is great, like Daniel said. The next thing which they're going to do as well, another acquirers assume, is like diversification, because you should never put all your eggs in the one basket, even though this is the biggest basket in e-commerce, Amazon. So it's as simple as that. And I think one last question, and we'll wrap it up, from Jasmine Barretta. If each of you could enter any Amazon business today, what would it be? Okay. I guess I'll answer it. I wouldn't enter Amazon. I've been a business, like an e-commerce here, for 10 years. I catch the e-commerce trend early and I'm out. So right now we're actually helping people who would like to start selling. So I'm done, guys. Now it's your turn. What would you start?
Baby or sports brand, one of the two.
Okay, Daniel.
I would go for paddle rackets. I don't know if you know, it's a growing sport in Spain and South America, but it's like similar to tennis, but it's been growing like crazy. And I think I would start a brand in the US or in Sweden, those places where it's growing a lot.
Thanks, Daniel. And you, Adam?
First off, if I was launching a brand, I'd probably go first direct to consumer off Amazon, heavily leveraging Facebook advertising, then progress to Amazon. With that said, probably furniture.
Furniture.
Hmm. Yeah. Assembled furniture, small to ship, is a healthy size market right now.
Yeah, exactly. Remote first is getting accelerated. So, you know, people need furniture to stay at home and do webinars when summer is over. So I think this is a good way to end the webinar. So in the meantime, we got a thunderstorm, so no beach for me, guys, but at least we did a very good webinar. So thanks, Omar. Thanks, Daniel. And thanks, Adam, especially for waking up that early. No, I hate to wake up early. So thank you for making the effort for that. So for everybody else, I mean, I will share the email with the recording. You have Omar, Daniel, Adam contact, so you can get in touch with them directly and you can discuss, you know, whatever other questions you have. So adios, everybody, to one of our attendees from Spain, Emilia. Adios for everybody like by in the States. And just enjoy the rest of the day, guys. Take care.
Thanks for attending. Bye-bye.
Bye. Thank you.